Oh, wow, that was fast. All right, good morning. Wow, okay, I got to share real quickly. Maria, the little lady over here that was just praying, that was prayed for her just a moment ago, she was just telling Cindy and I and another lady, a few weeks ago we prayed. She has a son who's 17 years old who has been deathly sick. And a few weeks ago we prayed for him, and she wanted to stop me as I was walking away from her. And she says, I got to tell you, Pastor, the Lord is healing my son already. He started eating. He started gaining weight. And she's seen the miracle in her son. And so when I mentioned that this morning, she goes, okay, well, I want my miracle. Why not? Why not, right? God's no respecter of persons. He did it for her son. Now he's going to do it for her. So let me just... Wow, welcome you this morning. Isn't it great to just be in the presence of the Lord, to be able to celebrate together? If you're just joining us for the first time this year, and I know there's a lot of things been going on, a lot of people been out and here and there and about and everywhere else, but let me remind you that we started this year with the idea of encountering God. That's our theme. That's our desire, to encounter God. We want to do more. That's one of our core values, is we believe in a personal encounter with a living God. And so we've put together some tools to help you with that. We've been talking from Matthew chapter 6 about prayer. Prayer is one of the key ways that we encounter God. And we put together this prayer guide. It's free of charge by the doors here in the foyer. If you go out the middle doors here, on your way out the doors on each side, there's a black cart, and these guides are there. We take the Lord's Prayer, our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. And we break that down for you. We give you scriptures. We give you names of God. We give you a section in here to just write down some of your prayer goals for this year that you're believing God for. And I hope you'll pick one of these up. Many of you already have. We have a few of them left. So if you'd like to get one of those, they're free. Also, we have this 21 days of fasting. Why we should fast, how we can fast, and some practical ways, as well as some links to more information about fasting. Once again, this is free. It's in the same spot as the other. And then an amazing tool that many of you have already purchased, and that is this book called The Circle Maker, one of the greatest faith-building books I've ever read on the subject of prayer. And while you're doing these 21 days of prayer and fasting, I really hope that you're taking time to just read. It's an easy read. Just a few minutes a day, you can read one of the chapters. It will inspire your prayers. I promise you, you will pray bigger prayers, and you will begin to believe that God honors big prayers. We insult God sometimes when we only pray for things which we can handle ourselves. Come on now. It's when we start saying, okay, God, I don't know how this can ever work, but I'm going to believe God for it, and I'm going to start praying for it. And so Circle Maker by Mark, these are only $10 at the merch area. Love for you to get that. And when you came in this morning, you should have received this little brochure. It's information that will tie in with the message that you're about to receive this morning. And it was so important. We felt like we wanted to put this in print for you. And Thomas and Robin McPhail helped us put this together. They are the directors of our Financial Peace University here at Christ Church, at Movement City Church. Okay. One mistake in the morning. But anyway, we're starting this new series, as Pastor Marcus just mentioned to you. And this is such a crucial series. In Matthew chapter 6, Jesus talked about three things as foundational for followers of Jesus Christ. And he started each of those three areas with the phrase, when you. He says, when you pray, don't do this, but do this. And he has this whole section on prayer. We've been talking about that. I talked about it. Pastor Brendan talked about it last week. And then he talks about when you fast. And he talks about this is what you should do and this is what you shouldn't do. And it's this expectation, you will do this, you will pray, you will fast. And here's the third, when he says, when you give, and then he talks about money. And money is one of those subjects that in church sometimes we go like, oh, okay, wow, is the church in trouble, or are we about to start a campaign? Okay, neither. I'm here to tell you, God's been good to us. You have been generous, you have been faithful, God has been good, amazing. But here's what I know, is that as followers of Jesus Christ, if we don't get the money that God has given us in line with God's way of doing things, money can become a trap. And the enemy can use money to break up relationships, to destroy our faith, and to block us from being able to accomplish what God wants to accomplish in fullness in our lives. So as we were preparing for this year, we decided that we wanted to, right here, while we're talking about encountering God, we want to take a week and we want to focus on talking about what does the Bible have to say about money. And as we began to prepare, we realized there is nobody better on planet Earth, in my opinion, to talk to us about money than Dave Ramsey. Some of you have heard him. He's on the radio. He is a speaker all over the United States, all over the world. He is the founder of Financial Peace University. We have literally taken over 1,000 people of our church family through Financial Peace University. It starts up again this month on January the 30th here at Christ at Movement City Church. Twice. Okay. So we decided that instead of one of us trying to talk about this, we would do something that we rarely ever do here at Christ Church. I can only remember one other time we've done this, and that is we're going to bring you a message by video this morning, a very powerful message that I believe can stir our hearts. So I'm going to ask you to open up your hearts, open up your ears, open up your minds, and let's listen to Dave Ramsey as he talks to us about handling money God's way. Come on. Welcome, Dave Ramsey.
38 years ago, my wife Sharon and I got married, and we were stupid. We didn't know anything. If we'd have known half of what we know now, we'd have known not to get married, because it was a mess. I was a beer-drinking, hell-raising hillbilly, and I talked her into marrying me, and we moved to Nashville and started off our lives. And about, of course, Nashville, y'all know about Nashville, right? It's the buckle of the Bible Belt. There's more Baptists there than people. And so we moved to Nashville, and about 2 weeks after we were brand new married, my wife, who had never discussed God or Jesus or anything else with me prior to marriage, remembered that she was a Baptist. And she gets up on Sunday morning and said, "We're going to church." And I said, "We are not doing anything. It is Sunday morning. I will be here watching football and drinking beer like all good rednecks." Well, that didn't go well. She got really upset, and she cried, and she was mad, and I didn't care. And she went storming out of the house, and it didn't take her long to find her tribe, because those Baptists are everywhere. And so she wanders in the back door of this little Baptist church, and they prayed at the end of service for her heathen husband. And this scene repeated itself every week for quite a while. It wasn't going so good. And so I decided I was going to get rich, and I got in one of these multi-level things, you know, those things where you make all your friends mad. And so me and my beer drinking buddy, we get in this thing together, and this is how bright Daryl and his other brother Daryl were. We would go to happy hour and then go make sales calls and couldn't figure out why we couldn't grow the business. Dumber than a rock, right? So then we heard that they were having one of their big rah-rah things, and if we went to this meeting, we could learn how to do it and have a yacht and a big house and all the stuff we were supposed to be having, and we weren't getting any of it. So we drive from Nashville down to Birmingham, Alabama, to the Alabama Theater. And have you ever gone back to something in your past and it shrunk? In my mind's eye, the Alabama Theater holds 10,000 people. We did an event there a while back. It holds 800. But me and Daryl were in the back of the balcony up there all day long with these guys telling us how to get rich and the stuff we should be doing and all these kinds of things. And it's a great sales conference or whatever in this thing. And the big guy gets up at the end. He's the closer, and he's the one we wanted to hear because he was who we wanted to be when we grow up. And whatever he said, we were going to do. And we had written down 5 things on the drive down there that if we learned these 5 things, we could be ready to do the business. And he was a great speaker, and it was as if he had our 5 things as his talk outline. He had credibility before, but by the time he finished answering all our questions about life, he owned us. You know what I'm talking about? And then he says, "There's one more thing." And we went, "No, we had 5, that's it." "One more thing. If you don't know God, you need to meet him. Because if you think business is about monetary transactions, you're going to fail. And you need to learn that people are important, and God's son Jesus will teach you that they're, the people are important, and you will not succeed in business until you understand people are important. And I looked at my buddy and I said, has he been talking to my wife? So he goes, I don't know. He says what to do, so we got to do that. And I said, well, I don't know what to do. You know what to do? No, I don't know what to do. We go back to the Hampton Inn or wherever it was we were staying. We get the Gideon's Bible out of the nightstand. We open it up. It's King James, Shakespeare, and Jesus. The chances of these two hillbillies getting through this is zero. Close that puppy up, put it in the nightstand. But I did go home. I told my wife, I said, we're going to church. And she said, who are you and what have you done with my husband? And we started visiting churches, and we went to some of those churches where people aren't happy. Y'all ever been to one of those churches? Where people look like they were weaned on a pickle? Not having fun. And then we went back door of this little church. This is 30, 40 years ago, right? So we go in the back door of this little church, and it was kind of stuff happening in there. About 400 people. It had something in the air, you know? And the people in the choir, they were like moving and stuff. And we're like, whoa, this is dangerous. And then one woman in the choir raised her hand like she knew the answer to some question. And so, and then they all started raising their hands. And I told Sharon, you know how you do when you're visiting churches, we're on the back row, sneak out, right? And so we're on the back row. I said, they get snakes out, I'm out of here. I'm just saying. We kept being drawn back to that little church. And that old pastor, about as good as you can get, he would say wonderful things from the pulpit, like, this is what the Bible says. And then if you don't agree with that, you're what's known as wrong. I love that. Like somebody, because I thought Christians were kind of wimpy, and he was like a man, you know? And his wife, you know, it's old school church. They'd stand at the back when everybody left and shake everybody's hand and give everybody a hug on the way out. It was a little church anyway. You could do that, right? And she's a big squishy woman, so she'd give you a big old grandma hug, you know? And you get that big grandma hug and his manliness. And that woman and his talks led me to Jesus. Changed my life. And I do everything backwards. Most people meet God at the bottom of a crisis of some kind. I met him on the way up. And I started buying, I left that little multi-level thing, I started buying and selling real estate, and I got rich. At least by a kid from Antioch, Tennessee standards. By the time I was 26, I had $4 million worth of real estate, a little over $1 million net worth, and I was making $250,000 a year in the early 80s. That's $20,000 a month. Now, I don't know what neighborhood you grew up in, but where I grew up, we called that rich. And it was fun, too. Sometimes I hear these people say, all those rich people are miserable. Uh-uh. We were having fun, F-U-N fun. I mean, I had that car I always wanted. You know that car, if you ever got some money, I'd get that car. You know that car? The car I always wanted was, I wanted a Jaguar. Because no one in the neighborhood I grew up in could spell Jaguar. Much less knew what it was or how much it cost, so it was exotic. I got me a Jaguar, and baby, within 90 days, I was a Jaguar. You know, it's like, right, you know? I was having fun, man. We went to Hawaii, and we loved it. That water is so blue. We went back, and then we went back again. We loved it. We were having fun. Now, I'm not here to tell you money will make you happy, and I'm certainly not a quote-unquote prosperity gospel guy, but money's not evil either. It's not in Scripture. The Bible doesn't say that money is the root of all evil. It says the love of money is the root of all evil. What I have discovered now 30 years later is that money makes you more of what you already are. It magnifies the good and exposes the bad brightly. If you have a temper and you get money, Lord, help the people around you. You will be a rageaholic tyrant. I mean, you will be out of control. If you are generous and give and you get money, you'll become what the world calls a philanthropist, and you will impact entire communities with the wealth that God allows you to manage. You become more of what you are. And some of the people around you when you get money become more of what they are. Like the crazy in your family gets crazier. And listen, let me just tell y'all, every family has crazy. And if you think there's not crazy in your family, that means it's you. This is how it works, you guys. And so we were blowing and going. Everything was so good. We were cooking. And I had done some stupid stuff. How many of y'all ever do something stupid with money? How many of you that didn't raise your hand have a problem with lying? All of us have done some stupid stuff with money. And I had borrowed too much money. I had $4 million worth of real estate, but I had $3 million worth of debt on it. It was on short-term notes because I was flipping this house, flipping these houses before there was cable TV to tell you how. And so we're just chugging along. The bank gets sold to another bank, and a guy in another city looked down and said, there's a kid, 26 years old, owes us millions of dollars. Let's limit this relationship, which is banker talk for ruin his life. And they called our notes. The short version of the story is we spent the next 2.5 years of our life losing everything we owned. We were sued. We were sued so much, we're on a first name basis with the guy with the sheriff's department bringing the lawsuit papers. Little pink slip thing, and Sharon's like making him cookies. Hey, Errol, how's it doing today? Just good, Miss Sharon, here's your another one. And so, I mean, it was just like coming at us like crazy. We had a brand new baby and a toddler. Our marriage was hanging on by a thread. Because you can have some money fights now. You can have fights, but in a marriage, you can have some money fights. Number one cause of divorce, number one cause of disagreement in America today, money fights. Now, we didn't get a divorce. We held on to each other, but sometimes it was just to get a better grip. Y'all know what I'm talking about, right? She's from East Tennessee, the hills of East Tennessee, and frying pan throwing there is an Olympic event. Finally, after standing in the shower with so hot in my face, I could hardly stand. I was just standing there and crying because I was so scared I couldn't breathe. Year after year, month after month, finally we were bankrupt. So I met God on the way up, but I got to know him on the way down. And it changed everything. I had an I surrender all moment, and I'm not talking about a Baptist altar call. I'm talking about I surrendered. We're doing it your way, and I don't care what anybody else thinks. You're it. You are the Lord. You are in charge. And this is your instruction manual. We're doing it this way, and I don't care what the other books say. And I don't care if somebody's mad, and I don't care if somebody's sad. We're doing it this way, period. And there's a lot of stuff in here. I mean, I'm going to raise my kids this way. My kids are like, Dad, what's this rod stuff? And I'm like, come here, baby, I'll show you. I'm going to run my marriage this way. Submit yourselves one to another. Oh, no. That means I got to dry dishes. 2,500 scriptures on how to handle money and possessions. God's concerned about teaching us how to manage his stuff, his way for his glory. He's really concerned about that. And I said, okay, God, apparently I'm an ignoramus when it comes to money. I've got a degree in finance and all these letters and licenses after my name, but here I sit broke. So there's a problem with the knowledge base I was operating from. Something's got to change. What does it say about money? And it's all in here. It's crazy, y'all. I'm still learning stuff 30 years after I first started studying this subject. And it's crazy how in-depth and detailed and nuanced the instruction is. It's all there. But you can't just carry it. You got to open it and read it. I mean, it's the osmosis thing running up your arm doesn't work. You got to really get, you got to, and man, it's hard. It's hard. So I got a bunch of young people working on my team. There's about 964 folks on our team right now, and give or take one. And a bunch of youngins on my team, and I came in the day, and one of these young guys was doing the stuff wrong that he's supposed to be doing. And I was like, hey, don't do it that way. Do it this way. Huh? I said, no, that's wrong. There's a right way to do it and a wrong way to do it. You're doing it wrong. This is the right way. Do it this way. And he's like, okay. I come back 2 days later, he's doing it wrong again. The same way? I'm like, hey, again, one more time. This is the way. Don't do it that way. Do it this way. I come back 2 weeks later, he's doing it wrong again. I'm like, boy, we're going to set you free in Jesus' name. Okay? This is ridiculous. And he looks at me and he says, I'm not like you. And I said, you don't have to be like me. You just got to do it the right way. And to the extent you're not like me in the way you do it, you need to change. When you're doing it wrong, you need to change. When you're walking the wrong way in Christianity, God says, stop. You're doing it wrong. When we change, that's called repentance in our world. I got a lot of stuff I get to repent for every day because I do so much stuff wrong. But this money stuff, I've studied it and studied it and studied it, and I've been doing it right for decades now, and it works. And I'm a lot better husband than the guy that woman married 38 years ago. And I'm a lot better daddy than I was when I started. And matter of fact, I got grandbabies now, and if I'd have known how great grandkids are going to be, I'd have been nicer to their parents. And so, I mean, it's my kids are like, who are you? You want this one back? Okay. So this one smells. You can have it. And so, oh, man, it's you get better if you change. The technical theological term would be called sanctification. Over time, we get better if we change. So let's talk about the five things that the Bible says we should do with money. Now, there's a whole bunch of them, but if you do these five over a couple decades, 100% of the time, you will get results that will blow your ever-loving mind. 100% of the time. Because let me just tell you, if you plant corn, don't be shocked if corn grows. As you sow, so shall you reap. If you plant nothing and wait on the government, don't be surprised if you have mud. This is how it works. You are in charge of planting. He is in charge of sunshine and rain. And there's this dance that we do with God between our works and his blessings and provision and protection that causes this thing where his children, the heirs to the throne, a royal priesthood, are blessed. And this is how we do it. The first thing is, you get on a written plan. We call it a budget in the financial world. Jesus said, don't build a tower without first counting the cost, lest you get halfway up and you're unable to finish, and all who see you begin to mock you and say, this man began to build and was unable to finish. Don't build a tower without first counting the cost. My friend Zig Ziglar used to say, if you aim at nothing, you will hit it every time. My friend John Maxwell says, a budget is people telling their money what to do instead of wondering where it went. Winning is an intentional act. When the Super Bowl is over and the little reporter runs over and says, how did you win? The guy never goes, I don't know. I just got off the bus and this thing happened. Getting to the Super Bowl is an intentional act over decades of developing your skill. No one accidentally grows a bumper crop unless it's weeds. No one. So plant something, control the process, control the controllables, write it down. This is my plan. Thank you, Lord. I'm going to do this. I'm going to manage your stuff. I'm going to take care of my own household first. It's in there, remember? And we're going to live this plan out, and we're going to do this thing. It changes everything. The second thing is you need to get out of debt. Now, we knew Dave Ramsey was going to say this. That's a fairly predictable thing coming out of my mouth. But here's the deal. The borrower really is slave to the lender. The rich rules over the poor, and the borrower is slave to the lender. I've experienced that. I lost everything because I let other people have control over my life. You know what that's called? A master. Well, Dave, I don't know if I agree with all your theories about debt. It's America. You have the right to be wrong. My old pastor used to say, a man with an experience is not at the mercy of a man with an opinion. I've led more people out of debt and into wealth than anybody breathing on the planet today. And I'm not bragging. I just showed them how to do it God's ways. I didn't make up any of this. I stole it all from God and your grandmother. And so we're going to get out of debt. because it's no fun trying to be married like this, right? Knock your glasses off doing that. This is crazy, you guys. We're walking through our lives where all the money comes in, all the money goes out, and only the names are changed to protect the innocent. We make tons of money and we have none and we can't figure out why. I know why. You gave it all to a financial system that's designed to take it from you. You surrendered it. And we've got to stop. So I quit borrowing money. Period. For anything, for any reason. And this weird thing happened when I didn't have any payments and I made an income. I had money. It was so strange. And then when I got money and I bought an asset that created income that I paid cash for, I got to keep all that. There was no payment, except for what the government takes, but I mean, there was no payment. And it was an amazing experience. And the first few years were tough because, you know, there was stuff I wanted to do and I didn't have the money. And I had to learn this magic ancient word called no. Most people don't know this word. You press your tongue towards the roof of your mouth, you release air. No. It's tough. You're not allowed to say it in our world anymore. It's politically incorrect. So, you know, what I did was we got the scissors out and we said, no more. I'm not going to play you guys' game anymore. It's time for a plastectomy. It's time for plastic surgery. Citibank, what's in your wallet? Money. American Distress, thank you. Discover Bondage. Bank of America. Oh my gosh. You don't have any credit cards? No, not for 38 years. Well, 30 years. That's when I went bankrupt. They wouldn't give me one at first. And then later after they would give me, I didn't want it because I had learned this stuff from the Bible. And this is my wallet. Green president's faces, four pieces of plastic, my debit card on my business, my debit card for my home, my driver's license, and my handgun carry permit. Oh, rednecks in Oklahoma, I see. Okay. I had a guy call me on the radio and he's like, you're going to kill me. My truck payment. I said, how much is your truck payment? $763. You have a $700 truck payment? Yeah. I said, how much is your house payment? I live in a double wide, $550. I said, oh, man. I said, dude, if your truck payment is bigger than your house payment, you might be a redneck. The borrower is slave to the lender. You got to sell that truck, dude. It owns you. You don't own it. It sounded good at the time. And you and I both know the reason you called me is you just wanted somebody else to say it out loud with you who's also done stupid because I know what stupid looks like. Son, that's stupid. That truck's got to go. You're saying I got to sell my truck? I said, what'd you just say? Of course I said you sell your truck. I didn't stutter. Thing owns you, man. This is crazy. Get you a truck that you can own instead of it owns you. This is just crazy. The third one surprises people, and that's foster high-quality relationships. The Bible says, be not deceived. Evil company corrupts good habits. Did you know you become who you hang around with? I was up north the other day, and do you know all those people talk alike? They got accents. They thought I had one, but they had a group accent thing going. I saw it. And when they move down south, they stay there long enough, we'll teach them how to talk, right? And they're fun. I love Yankees. They're awesome. But it's fun. There's a couple in here right now. But we can have all the fun we want. You know you become who you hang around with. Studies say that your 10 closest friends over the next decade, your income will be within 10 to 15% of the average of your 10 closest friends. And some of you are going, I need some new friends. Well, maybe. I mean, you don't let your little son, your little Johnny, run around with the weed head down the street because you know if you do, he's going to turn into a weed head. Right? He comes home talking language. We don't talk in our house. You go, where'd you pick that up? Because you didn't pick it up in here. So where'd you, you know, oh, yeah, okay. Well, you become who you hang around with. Be not deceived. Evil company corrupts good habits. So hang out with generous people and you will be generous people. Hang out with people who read the Bible. You'll end up reading the Bible. You can't keep yourself from doing it. Hang out with people who treat their wives with respect, men, and you will find men who treat their wives with respect, and you'll start treating yours that way. It's an amazing thing that happens. It's a weird thing that happens. So choose carefully. Now, I'm not talking about being nice to someone or snubbing other people. I'm nice to anybody. I love people. I love people that are wrong even. I love people, okay? But I'm talking about my crew, the men in my life that shape my language, the men in my life that impact my spiritual walk, my generosity, my thinking in business, and my acumen. Who are the men in my life that are doing that? Ladies, the same thing for you. You're gonna become who you hung around with. Now, the next one is save and invest. See, if you don't have any payments and you got a plan, the first thing you're gonna wanna do is save and invest, because in the house of the wise are stores of choice food and oil. And the rest of that proverb says, and a foolish man devours all he has. If you spend everything you make, biblically speaking, you're a fool. I didn't say it, God did, don't get mad at me. But I have been a fool, big red arrow, fool, 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 fool. I know what being a fool feels like. It feels like being broke, because I spent everything I made. Because I've always been able to make money, I just wasn't able to keep it. I always thought I could out-earn my stupidity. And I tried it for a long time, it doesn't work. Save and invest. You're saving for an emergency fund first. Save 3 to 6 months to get ready for maybe something like a what? A rainy day. Visual aid, 2020. Right? Man, I mean, what if you had no payments and a big $20,000 emergency fund in 2020 happened? Or what if you had $20,000 in payments and no money for emergencies in 2020 happened? Do you have two different results? The answer is yes. In the house of the wise are stores of choice food and oil. And then that leads you to the position to be incredibly, outrageously generous. It's hard to be generous when you're broke. You can be generous and smile and open the door for somebody, but I'm talking about writing a check to feed hungry babies. I'm talking about buying a single mom a car. I'm talking about you can reach over and pay somebody who's struggling's light bill through the end of the year. I'm talking about outrageous, even sometimes spontaneous generosity. And you can do that if you're not broke. And if you've got your stuff taken care of at home. If my light bill is paid, I can help somebody. If I'm still fretting over here, I don't even see them. God loves a cheerful giver. He loves a cheerful giver. So I want you to try this next time there's a holiday, maybe Easter or Thanksgiving or something like that, and you're driving to grandma's house with the kids. Now you're gonna go have a big feast that day, but on the way, I want you to do something crazy. I want you to stop at the Waffle House. Leave the kids in the car and motor running. Pull up in front of the window so you can see inside and the people in your car can see inside. I want you to go inside by yourself, leave them out there, they'll be running their mouth anyway. Kids, put the screens down, watch this. Go in there, have a cup of coffee at the counter. She'll come to the counter. She'll pour your coffee. This is Thanksgiving morning. You know, he's working on Thanksgiving morning at Waffle House. You pay for your coffee, and I want you to take 3 or 4 of these Uncle Benjamin Franklin pictures, $100 bills, and I want you to slide them under the cup and slip out. Go out in the car. Tell the kids, hey, watch God work. Watch what God does when he shows off. She'll come over, she'll pick that stuff up, and she'll look at it. She wonders if it's a trick, because in her life, it's been so long since anything good has happened to her. And then when she realizes it's real, and then even if she was in church that Sunday or hadn't been in church in 20 years of Sundays, 100% of the time the human spirit can smell God's spirit. She knows what's going on. And 100% of the time after she does this, she'll go, thank you. And then she looks one more time. When she realizes no one's looking and she has no idea, there's a family with a 6-year-old sitting in a van watching her inside, whose dad or mom just pulled this idea off. And the 6-year-old's life is being permanently changed while he watches this. Then she goes into and does a Snoopy dance. Because that's the whole difference in her month. Now, I want you to go spend $300 with your spouse on a really nice night out and enjoy yourself. If we being evil know how to...
Sorry. Would you bow your heads with me a moment? Dave talks to us about getting out of debt. Some powerful principles that he just shared with us. I want you to realize something this morning. We all have a debt. It's called a sin debt. And that only through the Lord Jesus Christ was that debt paid. And this morning, some of you need to decide to take the first step in your relationship with God, and that is say, God, I'm walking the wrong way, and I need to change the direction I'm walking. Take a step to say, God, I believe Jesus is your son, that he died on the cross of Calvary to pay the price for my sin. And today, I want Jesus to be in charge of every part of my life. I want his forgiveness, and I want to start living my life the way he wants me to live it. Father, I pray for men and women, young men and young ladies today in this room, those joining us online, that today would be the day that they would make a choice to declare you to be their Lord and Savior. Father, I pray for every one of us that today would be the day that we choose that we're going to honor you with the resources that you've given to us, and that we would begin to live in freedom because we're being obedient with the resources you've given us today. Lord, I thank you for that. I ask that in Jesus' name, and everyone that agreed said, amen. Come on, let's give the Lord a hand right now. Amen. When you came in this morning, you received one of these cards. I'd like for everybody to take the card out right now, okay? Take this out for me. Some of you this morning, you're guest with us today. And on one side, it says guest, and there's information about what's happening here at Christ, at Movement City Church, how you can be a part. That's three times in one morning, okay. We'd love for you to check out these opportunities. At the bottom of that, there's a place for you to let us know a little bit about you and about how we can help you in your spiritual journey. In just a moment, the conclusion of the morning, we're going to have some gifts right over here to my left and your right that would love to just shake your hand, say hi to you, and give you a gift as our way of saying thanks for being with us. On the bottom section also, for all of us, there's something called next steps. Some of you this morning, you said, today I received Christ. Some of you say, I'd like to be a part in a small group. And some of you, maybe you say, you know what? After listening to Dave, I realize I need to get my finances in order, and I need to take Financial Peace University. So if you fill out this bottom section with your name and with a phone number and email, and just right there on the bottom of the card, FPU, that's Financial Peace University. You don't have to spell it all out, just FPU. If you fill that out, drop it in the offering that's going to be received in just a moment. Some of our team will contact you. We'll let you know about how you can be involved in Financial Peace University. It's a 9-week class. It's taught by Dave Ramsey by video. I promise you, it'll be life-changing for you. So we'd love for you to be a part of that. Well, Dave finished this morning with talking about generosity. I tell you, I've heard him tell that story about the challenge for Waffle House many times. I cry every time. I can mentally imagine that mom working that counter and suddenly realizing that somebody just gave her $300. I don't know about you, but folks, that's what I want my life to be like. I want my life to be marked with a life of generosity. The Bible teaches us that God is the one who's given us things. He gives us things so that we can be blessed, so that we can be a blessing. And it all starts when we bring to God his tithe and our offerings. So right now, our service team is going to come. and they're going to prepare to give us the opportunity to worship the Lord with his tithe and our offerings. If you filled out the cards, prayer request, any way that we can pray for you, praise reports, put those there. We'd love to pray with you this week. Heavenly Father, we thank you right now for your blessings, your favor. Thank you for what you're doing in this body. Thank you, Lord, that you are working in us and through us today. We speak blessings today over the gift, blessings over the givers, as we partner with you in this strategic area of handling money God's way. I thank you for that in Jesus' name. And everyone that agreed said, amen. Amen. God bless you as you give.